sing with us.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met. Till I met you.
All right.
Ooh, right at you. Go ahead and have a seat for a minute. Y'all know I take just a minute to get rocking and rolling. If you're joining us online, you're going to see a little different setup. And that means that we're waiting for you to come hang out with us on Sunday. So thank you for inviting us into your space. Thank you for everyone who's here today. First and foremost, while we're sitting down, let's take a moment just to say thank you to the folks who are part of Memorial Day. We're going to celebrate this tomorrow. So let's just give a round of applause, because I think all of us have been affected by that, right? Like, we know that freedom doesn't come free, right? Like, we know that sacrifices were made, and this holiday has actually even grown, not just for those who have served in the military, but for those who were first responders as we walked through 9/11 not too long ago. And so if you know someone in your family, there's someone in your family that's walked through that, thank you for your sacrifice, because we know that it's the entire family that goes to war when we're at war. It's the entire family. So thank you. I know all of us have been doing that. So over these next few weeks, over these next few days, today and tomorrow, just think of family, a Gold Star family specifically, or someone who's lost someone in their family that's a first responder. And so that being said, here every week we know we meet, we get to hang out, we have a good time. I love that we get to do that at Divine Church. And we're all about bringing heaven to earth. That's what that video talked about. May peace be on earth and bring heaven to earth. So there are a couple ways that we do that each and every week. And we say it all the time. It's your first Sunday. How we bring heaven to earth is we have great breakfast. But also we have a gift for you after the service. So if you come hang out with us, it's your first time here. Right now, I think we see some familiar faces. But if it's your first time here and you get to hang out with us, we've got an awesome gift with you where we can exchange information with you after the service. If you're watching online, email us at hello@thevine.tv. And we would love to just exchange information with you. We're not going to bug you or bother you. We just want to you to have our contact information if there's any way that we can serve you throughout the week. Also, guys, each and every week, how we bring heaven to earth is right now, literally, on Thursday nights, we're doing a Bible study that's called Experiencing God. We're just going into unit two, as we say, just into week two, so it's not too late. If you would like to be a part of that, what this study is about is literally heaven being here on earth and learning how to hear the voice of God. And since we're learning about hearing the voice of God and what that looks like, you can come hang out with us to do that. So make plans if you have time to come hang out with us on Thursday nights at 6:25. We do it at my house. For more information on that, go to hello@thevine.tv. And last but not least, we bring heaven to earth in how we give. Guys, we are a church that is extremely generous with our time, our talent, and our treasure. And I believe that when the world looks at the Vine Church, they see heaven on earth. They see people who are living out a life of generosity, living out a life of invitation. And we have got to see over $57,000 in all the tithes and offerings we received go back out into the local church around the world and into gospel-centered nonprofits. And I think that we're just getting started. I think that it's not the end of it. I think that we're just in the starting blocks of that. And so if you are part of that, I want to say thank you. Each and every person that's in this room absolutely is part of that. But if you're online and you give because you watch us online, thank you. Thank you for being a part of that. We don't talk about a percentage or about a number because it's really not about the finances. It's about the condition of your heart. And we know that Jesus is after your heart. So whatever he's laid on your heart to give today, if you want to be a part of that, go to thevine.tv/give, or located in the back left of the room today is our tithe box. You can give and be a part of that after the service. And we would love to just see what Jesus wants to do in and through you. So I'm about to pray. We're about to get our worship on. We're about to have a good time. And here's the thing that I want to tell you. Let's celebrate like heaven's on earth today. Let's do that. All right. So let's pray. And then after I get through praying, stand back up and we're going to continue in worship. So dear Jesus, thank you for this time. Thank you for allowing us to be here together today in your house. We don't deserve to be here. There's nothing that we have done that has made us worthy. But Jesus, because you came, we get to be a part of this. Jesus, we remember all of the Gold Star families. We remember all of the first responder families who have walked through incredible sacrifice and loss. And we want to celebrate and worship today to know that their sacrifice was not in vain. And Jesus, if there was ever a time that we could point to what your love looks like, we look to the soldier and we look to the first responder who go in every day knowing that it could be their last day on earth, and yet they still give all. So thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for letting us be here today. Thank you that you are here today. And I pray that we would just to continue to see you in a new way, and we would see where you're working, and we wouldn't be afraid to join in it. We love you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
You unravel me with a melody.
Thank you.
anticipation, we await the promise to come. Everything that you have spoken will come to pass. Let it be.
Thank you so much for this day, and just thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here. God, I just want to pray over this service. I want to pray over Tyler as he prepares to bring the word. And God, thank you so much for each and every person that we celebrate on Memorial Day, all the people that gave their lives so that we could do stuff like this, so that we could have services like this, so we could worship you and not have to live in fear. Just thank you for everything you do for us. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
I'm going to try to give this one, if I have to switch mics in a second, I'm going to try to give this one a shout like clockwork, like magic. How about those lights coming on? I'm going to try to give this one a shot, but if it starts popping, we're gonna switch out to a new microphone. So hang in here with me. So I'm thankful for everyone that's here today. Once again, I can't say it enough, as we get to celebrate Memorial Day and the sacrifice that is given. Seriously, let's love on everybody who's walked through that today. I know we've all been impacted by it. We have someone in our family now currently that is walking through that, or we know someone who is. So let's make sure that we thank them today, that we get to celebrate and do what we get to do. So over these past few weeks, I'm going to try to contain myself today. Today is something I'm really passionate about and something that Jesus has been working on me on as we dive in and finish up this series called I Want to Believe But. Because over these past few weeks, we've been unpacking it. We've all been there. We're either currently there or we're about to walk into living a life where we can say, I want to believe but. Because sometimes when following Jesus, like if it was easy, then we would never probably send that text message. And a lot of times when we do that, we feel guilty about it. And I want you to know, if you have done that, you're in great company today, because how many people in the room have ever been there, right? You can see the hands even more than ever, right? Like all of us have been there. And over these past few weeks, we've been talking about how in the world do we deal with a God that we can't see? How in the world do we deal with a God that seems like he doesn't answer our prayers, and a God who seems like he's not there? Like a lot of times in our life, we want to believe, but. And so today we're going to be walking through this series and wrapping it up. And the title of today's talk, or the title of today's message, is I Want to Believe But Stand With. So that being said, if you've got your Bible today, Today's a great day to do things technologically. If you got your Bible today, though, we're going to be hanging out mostly in the book of Matthew. We're going to start out in Matthew 7, and then we're going to end up in Acts. So we're going to be in a couple of different places as we walk through this. But if you've got your Bible, go ahead and get there. If not, we always have a way that you can follow us with technology because we partner with a Bible app and are able to allow you to follow along with us. So if that's you today, I'm going to show you how you can do that. For those that have heard it for the 100th time, it's okay. Someone's watching online right now and it's their first time hearing this. So if you'll download the Bible app from your favorite app store, and when you do that, you're going to go ahead and open that up. And when you open that up, go ahead and click on the More tab. Once you click on the More tab, what you're going to do is click on Events. Then after you click on Events, go ahead and see the Vine TV worship experience. Today you're going to see I Want to Believe But Stand With. And what you're going to do is you're going to see all the scripture we're going to walk through, but also a place where you can take notes personally and also a way that you can get our contact information if there's any way that we can serve you throughout the week or any way that we can pray with and for you. So give me just a second. While you get there and get your Bible ready, I'm going to swap out over here. I should have known better. What do we think? Ooh, look at there. The mic was hot today, y'all. It was good. That's how we were rolling. So today as we're rocking and rolling, and I'm going to mess up. If something falls, just point and laugh. It's going to be great today. So as we get rocking and rolling here today, this is actually going to keep me contained. Everybody who's working the camera is going to be excited because I'm going to be standing in the right spot. It's going to be awesome. So today as you get your Bible, you're going to get to Matthew 7, and I might start railing today, so just hang in here with me. Today's going to be an awesome message as we talk about this thing called Stand With. So I need some participation here. If you're taking notes, if you're following along online or you're following with your phone, I need you to do this for me. I want you to write down your five closest friends. Your five closest friends. Now, I'm not talking about the people that agree with you on everything, not the people who like your Facebook post or share it the most or retweet or people who keep your snap streaks alive. I'm talking about your five closest friends. Hint, if you haven't texted them in like 5 months, they're not your close friend. What I'm trying to get at is your five closest friends. I'm talking about these friends who know the 4 a.m. you. Like the 4 a.m. you, the real you. Who are the five closest friends in your life? These people that are your friends in your life, who are people in your life that are working along and working and walking in a God-given purpose with you as you walk into yours? Who are those five people in your life? Does everybody have their five? So here's the thing, for some of us, and one of the things God has always been working in me as your pastor on, is sometimes we can't fill that list with five. And what I want today for our church and what I want for you is, I want you to be someone's five today, and I want you to be able to have five that you can lean on and walk on and stand with no matter what in your life. Because if we're honest about relationships, they can be really, really messy. That find friends like that, that's the 4 a.m. you. I'm talking about the people that have the access to your garage right now. They have an extra key. They know the code. They've got the front door key. Do you have five people in your life that can do that? I would love to say that all of us do. I would love to tell you that at every time in my life, I've had those five people. And so what I know is since we walk into these relationships, it's so hard because we carry baggage. We carry scars. We've been betrayed. We've been hurt, we've been lied about, we've been talked about, we've been lied to, right? Like in our life, we struggle with those relationships. And one of the things that Jesus has been showing me and walking through as I was getting ready for this, because I will tell you, I'm kind of a loner, if you know anything about me. I'm a lone ranger, not the loner, anyway. Anyway, whatever it looks like. I'm not that, like, I tend to do things on my own and try to do things on my own, but God didn't create me to do life alone. And one of the things that he wanted me to share with you for real, is something he's been telling me this week. So many times the reason I choose to do life alone and I shouldn't is it's a trust issue. And I'll say, God, how can I trust them? If I give them all of me, how can I trust them? And Jesus has been saying this to me. I lived a life of invitation. I lived a life trusting you that you would bring heaven to earth. But the thing about those that I've placed around you is you got to give them a little bit of trust before you can decide if they're trustworthy. Because the worthy of trust, those two things go together. And so many times, maybe us in our life, maybe we can put five friends down, but they only know 99% of us. And so if you get anything out of today, I want them to know all of you. Now, hear me out. I'm not trying to tell you you need to get on Facebook and blast all your business. If you know me at all, I'm not a social media person, obviously. I wish I was. I was at the beginning, and now it's just age, I guess. guess. I don't know what it is, but I'm just not so much on social media. But in a life where we have platforms like this, where the I guess you could say the artificial is more great than ever, the world is looking for authentic. It's so much more attractive to be authentic than it is to be fake. And I'm afraid that sometimes in the church, we can try to be inauthentic and artificial instead of being real. And so to be real, we've got to be able to have five people in our life that are willing to stand with us and walk with us through every season and everything that we have going on. So today, maybe you've been asking the question, I want to believe, but I feel all alone. So that's what I want to address today as we talk about I want to believe, but, and this thing called stand with. So if you've got your Bible today, I might start getting really loud in a minute. Hang in here, because this is just stuff Jesus has been blowing my mind with here recently. So if you got your Bible today, get to Matthew 7, verse 24, and we're going to walk through verse 27. Matthew 7, verse 24 through verse 27. Everybody there? We ready? Lean on that fifth person. If you need a Bible, by the way, we've got free ones in the back hiding somewhere. Somewhere back there, we've got some free ones we would love to give you. So Matthew 7, verse 24, and we're going to literally build a foundation. Pastor joke. As we get here, you're going to see what happens. We're going to build a foundation for what we're walking through today. So Matthew 7, verse 24 says this. Therefore, if everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yes, yet it did not fall because it had the foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like the foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against his house, and it fell with a great crash. Way to crack up the message today, right? So here's what I see today. So many times in our life and so many times in relationships where we can struggle with relationships is this. I see that as a sign of the times. I see that as the world we live in today. Right now in the world we live in, everything that can be shaken is being shaken so that all that's left is the thing that can't be shaken. What I'm trying to tell you in our life is right now our foundations are being tested in the world today, inside the church and outside of the church. And what we have to understand is we have to build everything in our life on the thing that doesn't get shaken, on the rock. Maybe you've heard it this way in the Bible. The wheat is separating from the chaff right now in the world. The dross is falling off of the silver. We're getting purified. We're actually becoming more authentic in the church and how we live our life and how we do community together. And so when I looked at this story and I looked at what in the world did you want to show me in community with this Jesus, I saw this. Both of these builders faced the same storm. Both of these builders heard the word of God. The difference is how they responded to the word of God. One said, hey, I'm going to do it my way, and he built his house on sand. Maybe he had some cost savings. Maybe something happened, or maybe he was running behind. I don't know what it is, but he decided to not build his life on the rock. And when it comes to Jesus, and when it comes to following him, I want you to know that the rock that we can be built on is having great community in our life. And that's the hardest thing in the world for some of us to... Me included. I will tell you a lot of times in my life, because of that trust issue, because of where I've walked through, it's hard for me to give you 100%. Now, I'll give you 100% every Sunday that I'm with you. I'll give you 100%. But Jesus didn't create me just for Sunday. He created me for Monday through Saturday as well as Sunday. Same thing for you. And so what I've been learning all the way through is as we learn about this foundation of community in our life is this. What Jesus has been teaching me as your pastor. It's one thing to know the word of God, and it's one thing for you to come to me and say, the message was great, the experience was great, that's awesome, but that is not my function. That is not why I'm here. Actually, my function is to point you to Jesus in all I do, and the way that I can do that is make you as healthy as possible in your walk with Christ, and the way that we do that is how well we as a church do life together. All of this is awesome. All the things that we do is awesome, but the way that we do life together will be the determining factor of our health as a church. As a matter of fact, it's the way we do life with Jesus as our spiritual walk individually that determines how we do things and how we live life. And so today, that's why I want to share with you more about this building the foundation and talk to you about standing with each other through every season, no matter what. So we here at the Vine Church believe life change happens best inside of Christian community. right? Like, if you've ever gone to our sowers class, you've seen that. If you've ever gone online to see our Vine code, whatever it looks like in our life, we believe that life change happens best inside of Christian community. And because of that, we believe two are better than one. That famous marriage proverb that we share, right? Two are better than one. Woe is the man who falls alone. Who's there to help him up, and who is there to keep him warm at night? And the reason we do that is in our life, we have to understand we have blind spots. So I'm going to need some help from here. I think David's going to help me with this. If he's going to fumble up, we're going to see what happens. Yeah, did you see the crowd goes wild? This is awesome. So you're going to go back to back. So this is why we believe in great community at the Vine Church. You see, all of us have blind spots, right? Great community is like this. It's like when I have somebody who's got my six, who's got my back, because what happens is when I'm there, what can we not face? Like if we go this way, when we go this way, he's got my back. And then when I go this way, he's got my back. And we can face a lot of things. Now imagine if five people have their back to each other, how great it would be and how much we could face. But what ends up happening is we end up turning around. So many people in our life, we want to see eye to eye because we want to put up a front. And when we put up a front, we don't have anybody who's got our back. And real community in our life isn't the front that's in our life. It's not the people we see eye to eye with. It's the people who's got our back. And that's why we believe that life change happens best in Christian community. Thank you. You're awesome. How about a round of applause? He did that awesome, right? So what I'm trying to show you is Christian community is essential to your walk with Jesus, is essential to growing with Jesus. Yes, it's important to have a relationship with Jesus, but he didn't come to this earth and die to give us a full life just so that we alone could walk this life alone. And we know and we believe that life change happens best in Christian community. Matthew 22, verse 36 through 39 says it this way. It says, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." And a lot of us stop at that verse when it comes to Christian community. We stop right there. And we think, that's perfect. I love God, that's it. I don't have to worry about anything else. But you see, Jesus went on to say it this way. It's not just about loving God and hearing the word and maybe knowing a little bit what to do, but there's something else. There's another thing that goes to the formula. The missing link, if you will, is this. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is this. Love your neighbor as yourself. So in other words, Jesus says, love God and love others. If we want to live out the full potential that Jesus has given us in this life to be all that we've created to be, we've not only got to love God, we've got to love others. We've got to have people in our life that are walking with us. And so many times in our life, we leave the community out. And what I love about the setup that we have over the summer, if you get to hang out with us, is we've built a setup this summer that's going to increase community in our life. It's a place where it's intimate. It's a place where we get to know each other. We're not spread out. Like, we can feel the sweat dropping off of each other as we're rocking and rolling because we're doing life together. That's what it's all about. And what I want to tell you is maybe in your life you don't have those five friends. That's cool. Today's going to be an opportunity to gain one more. I'm going to tell you that. Maybe gain two more, maybe gain three more, maybe gain four more. Whatever that looks like in your life today is that. Because here's what I want to tell you, community looks like in your life if you don't have those five people. If you just do life with Jesus and you leave out the love others. So hang in here with me. Here's what it is. Without Christian community in our life, we're actually watering down the good news of Jesus. And we're turning it into regular news. Something we've heard before, something that's inauthentic, something that's artificial. He just becomes a man that walked the earth and did this thing and left us all alone to figure it out. And so we have to have community in our life because that's not what we're called to do, is do life alone. We have life change happens best in our Christian community because we have people who've got our back that walk with us. Matter of fact, I would say it this way. What I want for the Vine Church as we go forward, and what I believe Jesus is telling us at the Vine Church as we go forward, is this. I don't want us to be the church that falls in love with the message of Jesus, but is afraid to live out the method of Jesus. And the method of Jesus is to do life with each other. The method of Jesus is a life of invitation. The method of Jesus was literally this. I'm going to show you. Here's real how hard it is. Now, if I say this, go ahead, this is going to be heresy. But this is literally what Jesus did. He just walked up and said, follow me, follow me, follow me, follow me. And he did life with people. That simple. He had a life of invitation. It was wide open. His method was, I'm going to trust you with everything, even if you let me down. As a matter of fact, we know in his life that's what happened, right? He was denied. He was betrayed. He was beaten. He was crucified. Even when he rose again, he had his own disciples say, I'll believe it when I can put my hands in the scars. He knows what it feels like to be that way, so he created us for community. So I want to share with you three ways that we can have a foundation to stand with each other today. Three ways that we can have this solid foundation so that we can build our life on the rock. Because when the storm comes, and by the way, it will come, we are not taken away with it. We're not falling apart with a great fall. We're actually standing firm on the rock. All right? Are you ready? So today, I'll have a little bit of scripture in here as we go forward. So this is going to be just a lot of just hanging in here and sharing these three things. So number one, if you're taking notes, you want to build a life of community, a life of standing with. Number one, build beneath the surface. When I look at the life of the builder, he had to build beneath the surface. And what I mean by that is, have you ever seen a skyscraper being built? Bless you. Bless you from earlier. Have you ever seen a skyscraper being built? Has anybody ever just seen that? Look at all those hands. A lot of people build them in here. I'm just kidding. That's such a lie. If you've ever seen a skyscraper being built, have you ever seen the foundation being laid, how deep they have to go? At minimum, it's 14 stories deep. As a matter of fact, at least a third of it is underground for what it is for the height of it. So in other words, if you want to build a 50-story building, you've got to go 14 stories deep to have a solid foundation. They will keep digging deeper and deeper and deeper to have a foundation. And so just like those skyscrapers, as we want to live a life that God's called us to be and stand tall, no matter what wind, no matter what storm, no matter what's coming after us, we got to dig deep. We got to go beneath the surface. And what do I mean by that is so many times we got to have that communication in our life. We got to have those people in our life. What I'm getting at is that five friends that I told you to talk about, how many of them have your sit down and shut up card? I ain't talking about your mama. I ain't talking about your sister. I ain't talking about your friends. I mean, how many of those people, I am talking about your friends, but I'm not talking about those people who just agree with you. Those people, like, when you are just like, I've had enough, they're just like, sit down, shut up, and listen. I love you enough to tell you that. They're willing to dig in with you and walk with you through it. As a matter of fact, when I was thinking of this digging in that we could do, we got to get past our disappointments, our insecurities, and we've got to be grounded in Jesus. We've got to be dug in into what he called us to do. And just like we had people who have our back, we've got to look at this and say, what in the world is happening in my life? Is Jesus digging for community in my life? Because so many times we think we can once again be all in for living God alone, and we can't. Got to have that Christian community. Because this is what Jesus knew. We can never max out our potential alone. He had 12 people who ran from him when he went to the cross. He had 12 people who decided to abandon him. 12 people when he was at the most crazy time, when he was in the garden praying for all of us, his disciples slept. How many of us sleep on Jesus more than we want to admit? Myself included. And a lot of times the way I sleep on it is the community I have in my life. And the reason that he knew that is, believe it or not, the church at the time, when Jesus was here, he was building a church. It went from 12 when he started his 3 year of earthly ministry, to over 200,000 within 25 years. You say that's something that's important? Community is what drove all of it. And so, by the way, this is a different thing, and this will be another message for another time on the subject of digging. If God is digging something in your life and he's going deep in your life, will you trust him enough to know that he's just getting rid of the dirt? Or are you going to be mad at him because he's digging in your life? Maybe right now you feel like stuff just keeps getting removed left and right and you can't figure out what's going on with it. And I want to tell you, he's just trying to get to the foundation. He's just trying to get to where all that's left is him. And part of that is by people he puts in your life that can say, hey, this isn't what's best for you. This isn't what's right for you. God's got so much more from you. You've got to trust. I believe he's got a plan for you in your life. You got to get beneath the surface. We can't be putting up a front, because all we're doing is we're building buildings that are filled like houses of cars that are just ready to fall when the storm comes. So if you want to have community in your life, I want you to know to build beneath the surface. So look at your neighbor. This is how we go, Pastor Joe. Look at your neighbor and say, keep digging. Let Jesus know today, keep digging. You let him keep digging. Unlike what we tell our Vine kids sometimes, we don't like them digging. You know, they get in the nose. We don't deal with that, right? Like we say, stop, keep digging in the nose, right? But like seriously, in our life, we want Jesus to keep digging. I want Jesus to keep digging in your life. I ask Jesus to remove anything that's just crap, that's dirt out of my life. Keep digging. keep digging, because I know the deeper he gets down in me, the stronger the foundation is, the bigger thing he's building inside of me. And the same can be said for you. So build beneath the surface. Number two, build before the storm. Build before the storm. If you want to have great community in your life, you want to build beneath the surface. You got to build before the storm, because the storm is coming. James 5:16 says it this way. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. What do I mean by that? By building before the storm that way? Well, if you want healing in your life, call those five closest friends and y'all start praying about Jesus to do something in your life and watch what he does. You don't need a pastor to do that. You don't need a 1-800 number to do that. You don't need to send in to reap something. You don't need to call that hotline to get a sash or anything like that so that you can experience healing in your life. I'm sorry. It's not that. It's prayer. Prayer. If you want to build before the storm, you've got to have prayer. And that happens in community, because what does Jesus say? Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am also. If you really want to experience healing in your life, talk to your friends about having community. And this is how we build before the storm. We pray, because who wants to go into a storm weak? I don't. I don't want to go into surgery weak. I don't want to go into anything in my life weak. I want to be built on foundation. I want to be built strong. I want to know that when I come out of this storm, I'm going to be stronger than I was when I went into the storm, right? See, that's funny, because that's why we have Thursday nights. Now, I'm not telling you this isn't a shame plug. Like, I understand Thursdays are crazy, but I do Thursdays because I need Thursday night. I need that. I need community in my life. And what I want for you today is to say, maybe Thursday doesn't work for you. I want us to be able to look around the room, maybe for the folks who aren't here today that are on vacation, watching online, that'll be here next week. I want this for you too. Get with five people. Start praying together every week. Start hanging out together every week. And I know that we have this across ministries. Maybe some of us realize that there's only three people in our life. God's making the way for two more to be in it right now. Go look and see who he's going to bring to you this week to come be a part of community in your life, because community matters. We learn so much more together by building before the storm than we do without it. Then when that crazy circumstance comes up, because it's going to, you've got your friends to lean on. You've got the people in your life that are with you, that are willing to walk with you step by step. As a matter of fact, you've got people in your life that aren't afraid to say they're as broken as you are. That's what I love about real community. You don't have to put up a front and act like you got it all together and say, hey, this is perfect, I'm perfect, look at me, take my picture, ready to rock and roll, right? Like, reading this is awesome. Like, I get it, social media is a platform that we can share so much on, but how people really look at us in the Christian walk is when we walk through the storm, if we build a foundation before the storm, and how we react in the storm and after the storm to see how really authentic we are. And the authentic Christians who are real, that can say, I'm just as broken as you are, but I have the hope of Jesus, will make a greater impact than those who aren't. Because they built before the storm. They were praying before the storms. I wrote this down, and I have to share it with you, so it'll make sense in a second. If y'all don't get it, it's okay. We'll move on. You'll get it later. It's just how I roll. But so many times in my relationships and your relationships, all of us feel this way. A lot of times as we're building before the storm, that's a rough patch, a rough area of our life. I want you to know your relationship shouldn't feel like time served. Your relationship shouldn't feel like time served. You don't get it. What I'm saying is, that is my best friend. We learned how to read together. Awesome. Is that who Jesus needs in your life right now? It doesn't mean that you don't have to have that connection. Is that person going to a God-given purpose just like you? And it doesn't mean that they're not important. It doesn't mean that they don't have a place in your life. But maybe you're giving them more access to your life than you should be, and you're not preparing yourself for the storm. You're not building on the foundation before the storm. And so in your life, if you're in any relationship because it's time served, that's a prison that you're never going to be able to get out of. And all you're going to do is hold bitterness and anger, because neither one of you are ever going to live up to each other's expectation. And when you get there, that's when the breakup happens. That's when the divorce happens. That's when the chasm happens and the break apart happens. And that's not what I want for us, because that's the crack in the foundation. But you see, inside the church, that's what we do, isn't it? We show those cracks. We love those cracks. And then we go start our own thing over here. And then this person starts their own thing over here. And this person starts their own thing over here. And this person goes and starts their own thing over here. And that's not what God's called us to be. He's called us to be unified as one. And the way that we can do that is to build before the storm and having healthy relationships.
relationships, having healthy relationships that are ready to go, that are willing to pray with each other. As a matter of fact, people in our life that are willing to pray with us because, you know, when they saw the marriage that had the crack in the foundation and they prayed for it to be restored, they were actually there to celebrate with you when it was because they walked with you through it step by step. That's important in our life, isn't it? Same thing for the person who had the cancer that you prayed away and it was healed. Or you had the financial issue that was prayed away and it was healed. It's important to build before the storm by having prayer and having people in your life that pray. One of the ways that I see that God even built before the storm for us in our life that always reminds me of this. Go read this anytime in Genesis 1. You can go, I believe it's verse 26 or roundabout, so don't quote me on that. But verse 26, I believe it is. When we look at the beginning of the earth, when God created the heavens and the earth in our life, we look on the sixth day God created man. And we can struggle with community in our life, and we may say community is hard in our life, but when God created man, what was it that he said? Let us make man in our own image. Who was the us he was talking about? The Father, the Son, Jesus was there from the beginning. Community has been here from the foundations of the earth, and it's because he was preparing for the storm. Jesus was there at the beginning knowing that the very thing he was creating was a thing that he was going to be sitting down to rescue. That's what we get to live out in community. We get to see him rescue. We get to see him restore. We have to build before the storm. So today, as you read that, Jesus will get something to you in that. I just want you to know today, that you've got friends around you that want to build with you before the storm and walk with you through the storm so that when you come out of the storm, you're not only still standing, you're stronger than ever before. And last but not least, build beyond yourself. Build beyond yourself. Now we're going to be in Acts 2 here as we talk about this and we walk through this today. We talk about building beyond ourselves. So we got to build beneath the surface. We got to let Jesus keep digging. We got to keep digging. We got to dig in. We got to rock and roll with it. We just got to let him take all the dirt, get all the crap out so that way we can be built on the foundation. We got to build before the storm and how we pray for each other and we walk with each other step by step through every season. Then we got to build beyond ourselves. Acts 2 verse 42 says it this way, and it goes to verse 47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, praise Jesus and amen, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers who were together and had everything in common. Now, hear me out. I'm not going to tell you to go sell all your stuff and do all that. That ain't how I roll. If y'all know anything about me, there's a jet that I would like to, I'm just kidding. I'm just joking with y'all. I'm just kidding. It is what it is. Tough crowd, but they were laughing. Everybody here was laughing. If you're not laughing online, I hope you didn't wreck. It was great. I'm sure you were laughing that loud. So all believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. See, I love that here at the Vine Church. What I love, especially even here today, is we don't have a bunch of people who are slip in, slip out on Sunday, folks. They're willing to do life together. They're willing to do life together. Willing to stand bit by bit, piece by piece, to be like that Acts 2 church. Willing to get here together. Willing to understand that it's not about me and this, that we aren't a me-focused church, but we're literally, when Jesus came, he turned the world upside down and he turned that me into a we, and we're a we-focused church, and we go about there, and we want to be a church that just loves you right where you are and walks with you step by step through that. We got to do that together first, and I believe we do, and I believe we're just getting started doing that, but I believe that Jesus has people that are even listening right now that need to be a part of this. They need to be a part of what he's trying to do. Here's what I want us to be at the Vine Church, and I know that we are, and this is your pastor saying how I want to be, so hear me out. This is how I want to be, and I could be wrong, and this is where I see Jesus working and moving in my life, and this is how I want to be. I want to be known as the church that if somebody walks through a difficult circumstance all by themselves, it's because they chose to do it, not because we didn't know about it. Because we're so woven together in each other's lives that it's impossible. Because we're so woven in the body, like it says, that we celebrate and rejoice with those who rejoice. And when someone's suffering in the body, the whole body suffers. I want us to be known by that. I want to be known by that. I wish I could tell you I was perfect at that. I'm absolutely not. Jesus is working that in me. Jesus is working that through me. And it's the trust issue I told you about at the beginning. And I stand here today to say I'm not where I used to be, definitely not where I want to be, but by God's grace, I'm continuing to grow step by step in Him. And so for us, as we build beyond ourselves, that's what I want us to be. I want us to be so invested in each other. I want us to be so sold out, trusting, and bought into each other that we understand that we're sowers, sowing seeds for generations to come. Like, what if we looked at every person that was in our path throughout the rest of the day and we realized that we get to invest in them? We get to sow a seed. We get to build beyond ourselves the community. As a matter of fact, because we're so built on the foundation that is the rock, that we get to point to the foundation that is the rock, and that it may impact them 20 years from now. We may not even see it until eternity. And I love that we're willing to do that as a church, and I just want us to be able to do that as well in our relationships. Because here's the thing, I know that I can't do this alone. We can't do this alone. We have to do it together. And like I said at the beginning, what happened is, how do we do it, is Jesus lived this life of invitation. Like, He was always accused of being with the wrong people. I get accused of being with the wrong people a lot. I wish that was cool. Maybe I am with the wrong people a lot. I don't know. Whatever it is. But wherever it is in our life for you, could that be said of all of us? Could our life be such a great invitation that the church would say, I don't know what they're doing, but that's crazy. The religion and people would say that, or will we just show the relationship in us is so much stronger that we're willing to do life with each other step by step? It doesn't matter where you come from or what you do. I love that we're able to do that, and I want us to continue to grow in that, because I know that it's important for us, but it's the method of Jesus, a method of invitation, a method of just being willing to be an open book and say, hey, I screwed up. Hey, I'm screwed up, and I'm broken, and it seems like you are too. Let's walk with Jesus step by step and see what He shows us we need to do together, and then see what happens as we walk through that. So when I say that, and I say, what in the world does it look like? How in the world do we live a life of invitation? Well, I want to share with you here to wrap up the five elements of Christian community. The five elements of Christian community. And we're only going to read 14 chapters in the book of Leviticus when we do. Yes, really, the five elements of Christian community, and it's literally found there in Acts 2, and this is what I love about our church, and this is what I want to tell you. Maybe you don't have this. You're listening online, and maybe you don't have this in your life, and I just want to tell you, we try to live this out every day because we believe it's true. So it started with this. Number one, as you can tell, eat together. They weren't afraid to eat together. If you don't know anything about us, we're going to do some eating. I don't know about you, but we're going to do some eating, and it ain't going to be crap eating. It's going to be good eating. Like, it's going to be fill you up eating. Like, it's going to be like you're going to have the Holy Spirit on it eating. It's going to be anointed. Like, we got biscuits that's anointed with gravy over there, and there's all kinds of breakfast anointed in calories galore and carbs, so much so that you'll be willing to work out Monday through Saturday because you slept all Sunday afternoon. Whatever it is, they weren't afraid to eat together. And so what I want for us is I want to ask you, who in your life, is there always a place at the table for you? Who is that person in your life where there's always a place at the table for you? I would love to say, I want you all to know there's always a place at the table at my house for you anytime. You come on. Even if I'm not there, I'll tell you where the key is. You know, I just might freak out and be like, it ain't clean. And then y'all be like, ah, it's clean. And I'll be like, no, it ain't clean. Really, it ain't clean. Like, it'll be there. Like, I want us to know that each and every one of us have a place at the table. But here's the thing I also want the world to know. There's a place at the table for them. They can eat with us. They can feast with us, because it's not just about food, is it? That breaking bread connects you to something greater. It connects you to Jesus. It actually is this moment. He always shared a meal with the people. As we look through all of His miracles, we look through all of His parables, there was always a meal involved. Jesus knew how to get down. He knew there was a feast coming. And the reason that is because He was preparing us for the eternal feast, preparing us for what is about to come, and that's how He brought heaven down to earth for us, is so that we could feast together. So number one element of Christian community is eat together. And sharing meals are awesome. I'm just saying, it is what it is. Number two, pray together. So they ate together and they prayed together. Like I said, Jesus, we talked about it in James 5:16, how the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am also. If we really want to experience healing, we got to confess our sins to one another, say I messed up, and say, hey, let's pray about it. That's the hardest thing to do, isn't it? our world, because we don't want to be like, did you hear about their sin? Woo! We're going to pray for them. Yes, Jesus. But we forget about ourselves, right? We forget about ourselves. I know I do so many times in my life. So we know that prayer changes things. And like I said, I would love for us to be a part of a community where when the marriage is restored, we get to celebrate it, not because we saw it falling apart at the beginning and didn't see him again until the end. It's because we prayed for the restoration. We prayed for Jesus to do the work that only he could do. And at the end, we're not only celebrating it at the end, we're celebrating it in the middle when the dating happens again, when the pursuit of each other happens again, and they're walking through that again. We celebrated that, but also we're celebrating the end where we see Jesus do what he can only do, where we see him working and doing what only he can do. So who in our life can we pray about? In other words, who's the person that knows the 4 a.m. you that you can call to pray about that terrible heartburn you have? I don't know, whatever it is at 4 a.m. from the breakfast you ate on Sunday morning. I don't know what it was. But really, who in your life can do that? What I mean by that as well is, can we trust that prayer changes things? Like, I'll put it to you this way. I wonder the difference we can make in lives of our students, our Spurs students, if we literally sat down and prayed with them before graduation and prayed with them before they went to prom instead of telling them not what not to do. I'm pretty sure if they know Jesus, they know not what to do. But when I know that somebody in my life is praying for me, my goodness, the difference it makes in my life. I now all of a sudden not only do good, I'm like, man, I'm going to let them down too. And even though that's pride about worrying about them being let down, all of a sudden somebody in my life is praying for me. It's such an encouragement. When I get to send a text or I get a text message that said, hey, I don't know what's going on in your life today, but I'm praying for you. It starts making me wonder, what did I just send that message on Facebook? Like, what did I just share on social media? But for real, like, who is praying for us in our life? And you can obviously tell I don't have children, so I'm a children's expert. No, when I talk about praying about prom and I'm talking about praying about graduation, I'm not, so don't hear me out. I'm not a marriage expert, a parent expert. That's not me, but I will tell you, I know the power of prayer. It'd be crazy if we would trust the power of prayer and we prayed that over our students' lives, the difference that they can make, because they're going to do something that's so much greater than we are. And Jesus might be digging something out of them to make them be a stronger foundation for what they're going to do in generations to come. Let's trust that. They pray together. Number three, they give together. They give together. All of us live a life of generosity here at the Vine. We talk about it. It's not just about a number. It's about time, talent, and treasures. All of us. All of us have that. So we eat together, we pray together, we give together. And what I mean by that is we give all of our lives together. Like, we have people in our life like that we give together. We trust them enough with our life that we give them access to us. Like, we're on the doorstep of walking away from the faith, and they say, no, that's not what's best for you. I believe God's got so much more for you, and he's got plans for you. Those are people in our life that is a foundation of strong community. They give together. They aren't afraid to give together. That's what happened in the Acts 2 church. They sold their possessions because they were saying, hey, what we can do in the body of Christ together is stronger than what I can do by myself at my house. They had a life that was open, a life of invitation, a life that was willing to be given together. And so today, I just want us to see that so many times you may look at the person next to you and be like, we're completely opposite. I want you to know the strongest bonds in your life a lot of times happen because two unlikely objects come together and are willingly able to do something together. Two unlikely people, unlikely bonds make the strongest things. Like, in other words, when I look in, like, I can't think of what it is because I'm not a handyman, but you know, like the epoxy glue, you know, you got two things that come together to form the strongest bond ever. Two separate opposite things come together, and they're willingly able to do life together. They're willingly able to give all they have to each other. Watch what they can do, because that's something Jesus can use. That's something Jesus can use. Those are people that are willing to be, as we learn in the experience of God, molded and responded to from the potter. Those are people that are willing to have that and willing to do that. Number four, they worship together. They worship together. They worship together. And I'm not talking about just on Sundays, even though Sundays is incredible. But we understand, not only do we eat together, we pray together. I didn't say love, you're welcome. But they eat together, they pray together, they give together. They worship together because they understand their entire life is an act of worship. All that we do is an act of worship. As a matter of fact, when we're living our life as an act of worship, we don't have to search for happiness because we find it in our joy. But so many times in our life, when we're not worshiping the right way, we will search in our life for joy in our happiness. We getting to hang out with some folks, and we're reading a Bible plan about that right now. And what I'm meaning by that is so many times we want to feel happy about things in temporary and think we're going to find our joy in it. But real worship is finding the true joy and experiencing God and experiencing Jesus in our life. And when we do that, we'll be happy because we've experienced joy. Instead of trying to chase something that's temporal, we chase something that's eternal. So if you want to have real community in your life, you worship together. Now, that means this. On Thursday nights, I'm not going to sit here. If you hang out with me on Thursday, I'm not going to crank out the back iron music and start singing hymnals to you because you ain't never going to come back because you're going to be like, the dog's loose in the back. Oh, that's Tyler singing. Never mind. Like, you're going to say, did your neighbor get a cat? No, no. No, like, you're not going to have that. I mean, but like I said, living our life as an act of worship, which means we're willing to pour ourselves out into each other. And the fifth element of Christian community, last but not least, is this. Not only do we eat together, not only do we pray together, we give together, we worship, but we multiply. You see, the church grew. It says that Jesus added to their number daily what was happening. And let me ask you this. Do you realize that God wants you to grow? Do you believe that? Or do you believe that he wants you to stay the same? Do you believe that you've achieved all that he wants you to achieve, so you might as well just stay the same? God wants you to grow. And so when I was thinking about growth in our life, and I was thinking about growth in my life personally, so many times I was like, how in the world do I grow? Well, I started thinking of a plant I have over in the corner in my sunroom. I have a little plant, a little peace lily over there. And I started thinking about that when I talk about growth. You know, I could sing to that peace lily and it would definitely die. I could sing to that peace lily, or I could share a word of encouragement. I could read scripture to that peace lily. I could tell it how much it can grow all day long. I could do everything possible to that peace lily, but that isn't going to make it grow. The only way that that peace lily grows is if it's in right soil and the right sunlight. It's got the right nutrients. In other words, it's healthy. Healthy things grow. Have you ever had to tell a healthy baby to grow? It just grows because it's healthy. And so the fifth mark I say is multiply, but it's really health. How healthy we are, because healthy things multiply in our life. That's what God wants to do in our life. He wants us to be healthy, spiritually healthy, relationally healthy. We've got to be in community with each other to be healthy. And so for our life, if we really want to see God grow us, we want to see something multiply in our life, I just want to ask you, how healthy are you in that? It's not about how much you read the Bible. It's not about how much you pray. It's literally about loving God and loving others. See, that's just part of it. Part of it is community with Jesus. The other part is the people around you. So inside of our life, I wonder if we would trust God enough to do that. Because we know that life change happens best inside of Christian community. And so today, as we talked about standing with each other through every season, through the ups and downs of the day, and through many, many things going on, I believe that Jesus is trying to tell us today that we need to grow our five, right? We maybe needed to see today that he's trying to dig something out of us that we don't need. Maybe it's something we're fighting him to dig out of us. And he's saying, I'm just trying to get to the foundation. I'm just trying to get to the bedrock. You know, I don't know how many of you ever watched that show, Gold Rush or whatnot. It is what it is. Sometimes it's on. I know I'm dating myself here and getting, but anyway. But they have to get down to the bedrock to find the gold. It's in the deepest possible place to find the gold. And maybe that's what Jesus is doing in your life right now, as he's digging down to the bedrock, because that's where the gold is found. And would you trust that he's doing that with community in your life? Would you trust that he's doing that with people in your life that really do love you and want to do life with you? So today, I want to end how I started. Who are the five people in your life that are your closest friends? And if you don't have five, man, let's fix it today. Let's have some five. If you do have five, awesome. Ask those five if they've got five. And let's see what we can do. But my goal is, and what I would believe Jesus would have for each and every one of us, is to be one of the five on someone's list. And that we would have five people in our life that we can trust. You know, for each and every one of us, it's hard to maintain relationships. As a matter of fact, that thing what I'm talking about today is maybe I've talked about community in your life, and maybe I've talked about love and eating. Maybe you can be happy with eating and prayer. And I've talked about how you can build for the storms in your life, and maybe you just say, there's no way. Like, I want to believe all that stuff about Jesus. I want to believe all that stuff about God, but there's no way that's true. And I want to tell you, the only way that I'm standing here today is because it is. It's because of the but people in my life to be here. And what I want to tell you is maybe you're trying to look for community in your life. Maybe you've looked for it in that relationship. And it's just an endless cycle of failure after failure after failure. And the relationship hasn't changed, but the person you're with has changed in the relationship. Maybe that relationship isn't a person, it's your finance. And you've tried to do it your way. You know, we walked through FPU. You've applied all the steps, but you didn't do it. Like you tried to do it your way and it still ain't working out and you can't figure out why you're still in debt. Maybe all of a sudden it's not that. Maybe it's or your career. You've just been trying to live your life your way and you've been trying to do it. Hey, maybe it's you've been trying to find joy and you've sought out everything in this world that will give you community. Always end up short. You're realizing that something's missing. I want to tell you, we've all been there. You see, life change can happen around us. We can have life change happens and great causes can do some great things around us. But without the Christian community, without Jesus in it, is pointless. It's only temporary. It's only going to bring you happiness, not joy. And I want to tell you, in our life today, no matter what storm we walk through, God wants you to have joy. Jesus died to give you joy. And so maybe the thing that's missing in your life right now, the community that's missing in your life, is a relationship with the Father, or a relationship with Jesus. Because each and every one of us was born into sin. All of us were sentenced to death. None of us had this all figured out. And many of us tried to work our way through it through religion. We tried to work off the check boxes and said, if I say the right prayers, I do the right things, I know the right verses, I memorize the right things, I'm going to get there. And we realized that that was just all artificial. It was fake. It lacked authenticity. It required something greater. And that something greater was Jesus. Because God saw that we needed something greater. He sent his Son down. He lived the life we couldn't live, died the death we deserved on the cross, but loved us enough not to stay dead. He rose again on the third day. So if we really want to have community in our life, we've got to start with the rock. We've got to start with the foundation. And so you say, how do I do that? Well, Acts 3:19 says it this way. Peter says it this way there. It says, repent and then turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out. That times of refreshing may come. Maybe you're getting beat up by the storms of life and you can't understand what God is experiencing times of refreshing. I want to tell you, Jesus wants to give you that, no matter what this world throws at you. So the way that those of us who have a relationship have done that is we believe that Jesus is who he says he is. We've repented of our sins, just as that says. And we've trusted him as our Lord and Savior. So that all of us see that the only reason we're here today is for Jesus. And that he is the reason for all of it. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm going to ask everyone to repeat after me for the benefit of those who are coming to faith for the first time. This prayer, and it's not the words of this prayer that save you, it's the faith that Jesus is who he says he is. So if you'll repeat after me, dear Jesus, I believe I'm a sinner, separated from you. I believe you lived the life I couldn't live, died the death I deserved on the cross, but loved me enough not to stay dead, but rose again so that I may have life. Teach me to follow you step by step the rest of my life the best way I know how. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're watching online or if you can say for the first time that you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand and count. 1, 2, 3. That's you, and you can say that. If you're watching online, there's a hand that's popping up. Maybe you can just leave us a comment on Facebook, or you can reach out to us at hello@thevine.tv. Shoot us a text message or a phone call at 864-580-6698. Whatever that looks like, I would ask you to respond today, because times are refreshing on your way. If you really want to experience goodness in this life, you really want to experience what it feels like, no matter what the storm is coming, to have goodness in your life, to have joy in your life. It starts with Jesus. For everyone else in the room, I'm about to pray. We're about to sing about the goodness of God. And I would just pray that the times of refreshing from you, repenting and turning from your sin, wherever that was in your life that you would remember those times of refreshing, that you would see Jesus doing a work in you like never before. searching for you, that are searching for community, that are searching for something real, not something that's fake. And so, Jesus, I pray that we would just be real. We would be real honest to say that we don't have it all together. But because of your sacrifice, Jesus, because of what you have done, we can be free. We can go through the storms of this life, and we can withstand it no matter what, because we aren't built on anything we've done. We're built on you as the rock. So, Jesus, I pray in this moment that we would just experience those times of refreshing like never before. We love you, Jesus. We thank you that we get to be here today. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Stand with us.
So my life, you have been faithful.
All right, as we get ready to go out about this week, I'm excited. I'm thankful for everybody who's here today. I'm thankful for everybody who's here every week, and I'm praying that we get to know 100% of each other all the way through, and we see what Jesus is working and doing in throughout each and every one of us. So before we pray, I just want to say this as we lock it up and pray. I'm excited for next week. I want to tell you, over these next few weeks, we're going to be walking into a series called Level Up. And what it's going to be is, we just built the foundation today, and we're going to be up in our level in everything that we do, and we're going to be seeing Jesus work through the Psalms of Ascent. I can't wait to share that. I can't wait to walk with that. It's going to be awesome, and it's a great thing for us to share. So go ahead and lock it up with somebody around you. Go ahead, even if they didn't wear deo today, it's a warm, warm room. It's all right. God is faithful. So we're going to pray, and then we're going to have an awesome week. So dear Jesus, once again, thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity that you have given us. Thank you for this life that you've given us. Thank you for letting us live in a time such as this. Thank you for the sacrifice that this is built on, this country called the United States is built on. Jesus, it mimics your love. It's you all over it. The sacrifice that you gave us, let our life be built upon that foundation. Jesus, let us be bold enough to not be afraid to see you working in our lives and see you working around us and then join you in that, Jesus. Let us not be afraid and let us experience you like another way, like never before. Jesus, let us see that there is no other way but you. Let us just continue to come back here every week, Jesus. Let us grow stronger and grow more faithful to you. And let us grow stronger and grow more faithful to each other as we see you doing something incredible. Bring us back here safely next week. Let us have a great time with family and friends tomorrow, Jesus. If some of us are off, if others aren't, Jesus, I pray that tomorrow would be a day that is something that we'll look back on and be so incredible that we see that that's the day that it all changed for the better. We love you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Can't wait to level up with you next week.